Let me start with some overview. In two-dimensional therapy, it's a very old story. In 1980s, people already know how to solve this two-dimensional therapy. Because in two-dimensional, you have some, you have for a third century, you have test determinant and, okay, anyway, so there are two main differences. And the two-dimensional ice model have those critical conformal dimensions. Now, in my talk, I mainly focus on three-dimensional CFT. The traditional method is the Wilson-Fisher loop calculation. You just heard about it in previous talk. Another method is Monte Carlo simulation. Now, in my talk, we'll learn non-dimensional based numerical method. So, some papers. So those are the references. Okay. The main goal of my talk is to show you how to calculate three-dimensional icing dimension. So, if you understand how these two numbers come out of it, it's enough for today. Okay. Let me start by reviewing some ingredients already appeared in previous talk. I'm assuming this QFT have conformal signature. This M is the rotation generator and P is the momentum. K is the special conformal transformation. D is the scaling transformation. And I'm assuming fields form a representation of the global conformal group. And I define two types of field. One type I put primary field, means the field nearly by the special conformal transformation. If you let this K operator acting on this field, it vanishes. Another type of field is the descendant field, means you have some derivative acting on that field. So, once you know the scaling dimension of the primary field, you immediately know the scaling dimension of the descendant field. All the properties of the descendant field are completely determined by corresponding primary field.
So how do we know that, so when you're talking about primary fields, you're saying that K acting on the field is zero.
Yes.
Or the special. So how do we know that it's true or not? I mean, like for example, in the last talk, the proposed phi n is a primary field. And so how do we see that phi n acted on K? Do we just do the conformal transformation on it? Or?
Oh, okay, great. So his question is from the Lagrangian point of view.
Right.
So so in that case, you could argue in the equation motion, it becomes a descendant, no longer a primary field for the phi to the cube. But here, I don't concern about the Lagrangian. I'm just define the field which have this property. It's kind of like the momentum, the algebra approach to solve Schrödinger equation. You try to find the highest weight representation. So if you know the representation for SO3, you have some ladder operator, and you are assuming in your representation there will be some state which has the highest weight. Then here is similar. I'm assuming in your representation, this K, you can enter with this field by K. It will lower the conformal dimension. And if you are assuming the conformal dimension cannot be minus infinity, then some operator must be nullified by K. Okay. Now,
is there a reason why the conformal dimension is not? It's always bounded by from below.
Well, I will discuss this later.
Okay.
It will appear. Okay. Now, for the primary field, in the first talk you already heard the primary field will transform in a specific way. So mainly, for example, if you have this, if you scale this coordinate inside the correlator, you can move this lambda out of the correlator like this. And also there is a similar transformation law for the special Fermion transformation. If you combine special conformal transformation with scaling, it fits the two-point function uniquely in this way. It also fits the three-point function in this way. Now you might ask, what happened to four-point function? You cannot fix the four-point function by conformal symmetry. The reason is that if you have four-point, you can write down the combination like this. So one exercise, check this quantity is invariant on the special conformal transformation scaling. So scaling is obvious if you let all the Si go to lambda Xi. You say you will get lambda to the fourth here, the lambda to the fourth here. Therefore, they cancel out. So you can say, this quantity is invariant on the conformal symmetry. Therefore, no matter what you do, at the end, if you have four points, depends on quantities like this, and this cannot be fixed by conformal symmetry. Later in my talk, I will show you how four-point function is constrained. Okay, this is the assumption of conformal symmetry. Next, I'm assuming you have an awkward topology expansion. That means you multiply two operators together inside the correlator. Then this can be explained in terms of all the operators in your theory. Here, C is some function depends on x minus y, and it's possible to have some derivative. So on the right-hand side, in principle, you have all possible operators in the theory. Including primary field and also including descendant, because if you have derivative acting on this O, it's a descendant field.
This is true. I mean, the existence of the expansion is true for any quantum field theory, not necessarily CFT. Right.
I think there's some subtlety. It's in the CFT, this is rigorous and converge, but in UL QFT, this is some asymptotic expansions. The point here is in the CFT, this quantity you can actually calculate it. And in later of my talk, I will show how to calculate it.
I think even the statement that the OP itself gives the complete two-point function, that's what you mean by convergence, right?
Mm-hmm.
That the OP itself already gives the complete two-point function. I mean, in the sense that because it's a conformal field theory, so you have conformal symmetry.
Yes.
So short distance is the same thing as long distance.
Yes. Yes.
And therefore, the OP information is sufficient to give the whatever to get everything you want to know about correlation functions.
Oh, yeah.
But other than that, OP is always there for any QFT. I'm just making a distinction between.
I think in QFT, they only hold when the distance is very small.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Now, on the right hand side of this equation, you have all possible fields. You have primary, you have descendant. But in CFT, the relation, the relative coefficient between primary field and the descendant are uniquely fixed by conformal symmetry. How it can be fixed? You say you can plug in this term to here. So on the right hand side, you have this C structure acting on O from here and O from here, which become a two-point function. That is this part. On the long side, you have this structure. Therefore, it must be this term equals to that. So from here, you can calculate this thing order by order. So one exercise, try to do this for three scalar. On one side, you have this. If it's in a scalar, then you don't have this tensor structure. Oh, by the way, L is the spin of this operator. On the right hand side, you have a two-point function for the scalar. Now, you can see if you have a partial y acting on this, it's always high order in 1 over y. Therefore, on the left hand side, you can expand this in 1 over y. So, actually, what you can do is you can set z equals to 1. By using global symmetry, you can always set one coordinate to be 0. So, sorry. Then, on this term, you can divide by y, so this becomes s over y minus 1. Then expand this term in 1 over y. Matching both sides, you can find this structure. So my point is, you should consider this C structure is something known. So C is something completely fixed by conformal symmetry, up to the constant. So C is in this equation, you can say C is proportional to some constant here. We call this OPE coefficient. Questions so far? Okay. Now next, combine these two axioms, or we can calculate a four-point function. So here, I use the OPE assumption. Remember, the OPE assumption is telling you you have two operator, you contract this two operator, it become one operator. So if you have four-point function, you can contract this two operator, it becomes this C structure acting on this operator. Then you can also contract the last two operator, become this structure acting on this operator. Okay, now here, everything is known. C is known, this is known, two-point function is known, so everything is known. Therefore, I'm just defining something intimacy C, and I call this probable block. It depends on some cost ratio. Those are functions I said before. They are invariant on the conformal symmetry. Okay. Now, in 2D and 4D, you can actually compute this conformal block intimacy hypergeometric. Hypergeometric function. What we actually do here is you can first show this conformal block satisfy Casimir equation. By solving the, you can rewrite the Casimir equation as a hypergeometric equation, and you can show this is the solution. But the point is, we actually don't need this. All we need to know is those conformal blocks can be numerically approximate, and I will show you how to do it. One remark. Now, at this point, what is the CFT? The CFT is actually two sets of data. One set of data is those conformal dimension. Another set of data is the OPE coefficient. Because if I'm giving you these two sets of data, then you can start using this operator product expansion to contract whatever correlator to evaluate any endpoint function. When we say solving the QFT, we mean evaluate endpoint function. So once you know these two sets of data, the performance dimension of the operator and LPE coefficient, this safety is already, you should consider this safety is known if you know these two sets of data. Okay, now another consistent condition, axiom 3. We are assuming the correlator do not depend on the order of the operator appear in it. Namely, if we have a four-point function, you contract the first two operator, you contract the last two operator. If you're moving those operators, say I'm moving this operator to here, moving this operator to here. So I contract the 3 and 2, then contract 1 and 4. You should get the same thing. If you don't get the same thing, then it's not consistent. This turns out to be a crucial constraint on the safety data. So on this side, I have this summation from the OPE expansion. But on this side, I should have 1 and 3 exchanged. This x1 to become x32 and so on. Okay. Also, you can check this cost ratio u and v will exchange. So you have this equation. So for this factor, you can rewrite in terms of u and v. Now, let's define something called a conformal block like this. Then this equation can be rewrite in this form. By the way, the sum here is sum over all the primary operator in the phi phi OPE. It does not include the descendant. Why? Because the descendant we already summed. We already summed in this O. So then here, in this summation, it should only include the primary field, not include the descendant field. Questions? Okay.
So, sorry. So this is just weak contraction, right? In some sense,
yes.
You have weak contraction one way and weak contraction. A little bit similar, but the question is.
It's similar to weak contraction, but here. In QFT, the weight and diagram you have is an approximation, but here it's exact.
Yes, but I mean, again, I just want to make a distinction between what's different between CFT and QFT. So here, this equation will also hold in QFT.
That's true.
Because you're just doing different ordering OP. So this crossing, so-called crossing equation, is true for any quantum field theory.
Yes.
I think that so I guess an important thing is as you said before that,
yeah.
That it's really the OPE convergence because
yes,
you're using that therefore it's possible that two sides are convergent at the same time or the convergence radius overlap.
Yeah.
And in the usual quantum field theory, these two have there's no reason for these two to have any overlap. So this equation is useless in the usual QFT.
Yeah. And in the QFT. We don't have a symmetry to fix the relation between primary and descendant.
Yes,
so we don't
awesome.
Have this notation for conformal block. by the way, you might wondering, do we have more constraint from say 5 point or 6 point? You actually don't. If this is satisfied, actually endpoint function is guaranteed to be correct. So one example, that equation schematically means so that equation is this. And you ask sum over some intermediate state O. Now, let's consider the arbitrary 5-point function. You can apply this relation to here. Then it becomes this relation to this small part, it becomes this diagram. You can repeat this, you can get all possible 5-point diagram. Therefore, as long as this is satisfied, n-point function is guaranteed to satisfy h and 3. Any questions? Those are essential ingredients in CFT. Now I haven't talked about unitarity. What is unitarity? Unitarity means all the states in the Hilbert space should have positive norm. It's actually sufficient to just check the Hermitian operator. If the operator is not Hermitian, then we can replace this operator by some Hermitian combinations. And in the radial quantization, the two-point function and the Hilbert space are related in this way. Therefore, if you have a unitary CFT, you can always normalize two-point function in this form. By the way, what do we mean by normalize? I just told you compound symmetry fits two-point function. But if this is not 1, say if it's 1.5, it's still compatible with compound symmetry. But in that case, I can redefine my field. Phi go to 1 over square root of 1.5. Then it goes to this form. However, by doing this, I already assume the Hilbert space have a positive norm, so that the coefficient is positive. Okay, this is one thing. Another thing, the delta cannot be not be arbitrarily small. For example, the delta cannot be negative. Why it cannot be negative? Just give you an example. So, imagine you have an O, and the conformal dimension for this operator is delta. Now you can try to compute the norm of the descendant, the norm of this state. So the norm of this state is given by this. So K is the Hermitian conjugate to P. Mm-hmm. And I think probably Professor Chen will talk about more of this. So
why K is Hermitian conjugate to P?
Well, I'll show it from the algebra.
Okay.
At the end, I'll later creation operator.
Yeah. You can use algebra to exchange this two operator, and this will become O with the spinning operator D inside, and D acting on O gives you the spinning dimension. Now, if your O is negative, then either this norm will be negative, or this norm will be not negative. But I'm assuming all the states in the Hilbert space should have positive norm. Therefore, just from this simple argument, we can say delta must be positive. Of course, you can check more complicated conditions. For example, you can insert more and more p here. You can have a different bound. So the most restrictive bound are those we call the unitarity bound. That must be larger than space-time dimension divided by 2 minus 1 for spin 0 or greater. Any questions so far?
I mean, for the bottom one, that allows you to define twist.
Which one?
No, I mean, just you have that the delta is bounded for scalar operators, and it's also bounded by depending on spin. That's why it's natural to define twist.
Yeah, you can define delta minus L is twist. Okay. So last point is for Hermitian operators, OPE coefficient should always be real. Why is always be real? So 3-point is in this form. Now we take the Hermitian conjugate on both sides. On the left hand side, those operators are Hermitian, so it's just shift the order of the operator in the coordinate, but that doesn't matter. So left hand side is invariant on the Hermitian conjugation. But on the right hand side, this part is always real. So this will become a complex conjugate. So at the end, you get an equation to tell you the OP coefficient should be real. So what happens in non-unitary CFT? In non-unitary CFT, some state will become negative. That means the two-point function, we can only normalize two-point function with the minus sign. But remember when I define my conformal block, I'm always assuming I normalize this to be 1. If I insist to normalize the two-point function in this form, then that just means O is no longer Hermitian. Then some OPE coefficient will become imaginary. That just means lambda squared will become negative. So my final conclusion for this part is no matter the CFT is unitary or not, we always have the bootstrap equation. But for unitary CFT, lambda squared is positive, and the delta must be bigger than some unitarity bound. For non-unitary CFT, there is no such restriction. Questions? Now, let's see how we can use this, those actions we have. So, giving you this equation, let's try to find a linear function of R. By the way, the linear function means the function that eat the function depends on uv. So, linear function alpha means this alpha will eat some function on uv and pop out the number, pop out the real number, and it's acting on this function space linearly. So we want this alpha eat this block gives you 1. This block is the block with delta equals to 0, L equals to 0. That is the state corresponding to the vacuum. And we want this alpha acting on spin 0 block is I want alpha acting on this block is bigger than 1 for delta bigger than some delta 0. Delta 0 is some number I put in. Let's say delta 0 is 3.5. So I put in some number here. And I also assume this alpha acting on all the blocks in this sum other than spin 0 is bigger than 0 for delta bigger than unitarity bound. So I'm just impose those constraint. Now assuming I find this alpha, satisfy all those constraints, then I let this alpha acting on this equation. On the left hand side, you will have 1 plus some positive number plus some positive number, etc. So on left hand side, you always get something positive. On the right hand side, this alpha will act on 0, and alpha is a linear function. Acting on 0, it should be 0.